You made it to the bonus round. In this video, we're gonna step away from rifle scopes and talk about spotting scopes for a little bit because these are very useful in a variety of situations, not just at the range where you normally see them, but if you run any kind of tactical drills, especially with your friends, or if you want to use these out hunting, there are some scenarios where these can be really, really handy. These have some qualities that separate them pretty well from the rifle scope. We're gonna come back for one last video in the series that's going to be about recommended rings and mounts and some of the things that you can look for there. I've done a lot of testing with different types, and so I have some good budget ideas for a lot of you guys. But for now, yeah, let's dive into the spotting scope. The spotting scope is one that really favors its optical quality. This is a way to get a cleaner, clearer image than you can usually get with a similar rifle scope. So if you have a rifle scope that has really good glass, it's probably going to be limited in the size of that objective lens. And with these, not so much. You can get into some really big ones, like I think this is a 60 right here. You can step things up to 80. There are some models that have 100mm objective lens. And with that, and kind of the internal simplicity and some of the larger elements that you can get inside here, you can end up with some optical quality that can really just be pretty mind-blowing. That's why you'll have a guy out at the range that will have a very fine rifle scope, but then right next to him, he'll have a spotting scope as well. And I do this when I'm taking shots at longer ranges. For example, if I'm trying to print groups at 300 or 400 yards, in some cases, I won't be able to really see my impacts with one of the rifle scopes that I have here. Even though it has pretty darn good glass, it still might not be able to resolve as much detail as I'm gonna get through something like this. And in addition to seeing impacts, if you have a buddy with you out at the range, you can use this to spot your misses. So someone can tell you if you completely missed your target, they'll be able to very quickly tell you, okay, you need to correct so many targets over. That's kind of the way that we usually do it out in the field. There are a couple different ways to measure the distance that you have missed. If you know the size of your target, you might be able to call inches or centimeters, but in general, sometimes you can't really tell how far away something is, and you might have to call number of targets. That's a pretty quick way to do it. So if I'm taking a shot at a steel silhouette pig out at 300 meters, then my buddy can say, okay, you were off the nose by one full target length. So I can kind of measure the size of my target and bring everything back that much. And I might be able to dial, I might be able to just shift my point of aim, and I can make a hit. And that's the kind of call that you can use with actually just a crosshair reticle in your scope. You don't have to adjust so many milliradians. However, we can get into some of the scopes like the one that you see right here. This is the Bushnell, I think they called this the Folded Light Path or Folding Light Path, FLP. This one's pretty old. They stopped making this about 10 years ago, but this actually has a milliradian reticle in the first focal plane. That means that it's going to stretch and shrink along with the target as I change my zoom. It's always going to measure true. And if I am, you know, either spotting for somebody that has a milliradian scope or someone is spotting for me and I have one, then we can make a call from here and say you're off 3 milliradians to the left, and then I can make that adjustment through my scope. It's a very quick and handy way to not only shift that point of aim, but I can actually use the reticle to range targets as well. As long as I know roughly the size of my target, I can figure out how many mils it's covering, and then I can determine a range from that. I actually have some charts that I keep around to help me with that. So if I know that a coyote is generally this long or this high, then I can measure that and figure out how far away it is. So a spotting scope like this can be useful in a whole variety of situations out in at the range, so I can see my impacts, running some quick drills with friends, or I could use this for spotting game out in the field. Another way to spot those misses is by watching the bullet trace. That's that distortion in the air that's left behind the bullet. It's different than a vapor trail. I've seen both. I've seen vapor trail with 22-250 that was being fired through some warm, muggy air. It seems like it's a very rare thing for me to see, but it was actually a vortex of mist that was left behind the bullet that dissipated extremely quickly. But bullet trace is a good bit different. That is an area of high density air around the bullet. It's being pushed away, it's like a cone. And you can imagine maybe a glass kind of a cone flying through the air far away from you that dissipates over time. This is going to appear to your view a lot like the Predator in the original Predator movie, how it had that active camouflage, and you can see it just kind of distorting the background. It's a lot like that because that's kind of what's going on. You're looking through a sort of artificial lens that's being created out there with this high density air. It's bending the light as it goes through, and it's going to look like a kind of a delta on the way up, or I guess this is a lambda, and then it's going to be a V as it comes down. You'll watch it go up and then go down like this, this kind of a cone of distortion. And this is a very important thing to be able to see. Spend some time, if you can, watching for this. You usually have to be right behind the rifle scope or as close as you can behind the rifle scope, the guy that's shooting. And you can try to be a little bit on the lower side so you can see. And I think that's why we have a lot of these scopes that have the angled eyepiece. You can look down into it and be able to see that distortion as it flies through the air. This is a way to see your misses when conditions are very difficult, like if you have tall grass or you have mud that's absorbing your impacts. I have quite a bit of footage in my own library of very frustrating shoots out there where I couldn't see where I was hitting, and if I'd had somebody that was used to spotting trace with a spotting scope, we would have been able to tell what was going on. One more good use for a spotting scope, and probably the most common one that people use these for, is target identification. We have a whole lot of bird watchers or other wildlife watchers that use scopes just like this to be able to see animals and their movements really well, because you can get higher resolution, you can get really good color reproduction, you can get a lot of really good optical quality through these, and you can zoom in really far and be able to see lots of details about your animals. So if you're trying to determine, are you looking at a female bird of some type or a male, then you can get really close in and see differences in plumage. You can see all kinds of stuff. And if you are a hunter and you have a buddy that's willing to put down the rifle for a bit and spot for you, this could be really handy there as well. With all of these purposes in mind, it becomes pretty obvious that the most important things about these spotting scopes, it's going to be those optical qualities that we talked about in the last video. And you can take a lot of those techniques that I talked about and apply them to testing one of these as well. And actually, in this case, that's where this particular model falls down. Some of these folded light path ones that are very compact, they don't have quite the same ability to resolve details as some of your straight tube or some of the other kind of offset ones that you're going to see out there. Some of those really favor its image instead of features. And I kind of made a mistake when I bought this one. I had seen mixed reviews. People were talking about how it functioned out in the field. And I probably should have listened to more of the negative ones that were talking about how the image got a little bit mushy. So for myself, I'm actually looking for a new spotting scope right now. If you have a favorite that you like to use out at the range or in the field, please leave a comment down below and let me know what you think of yours, what you've used it for. If you use it out hunting, at the range, if you have used it in tactical drills, let me know how it works for you and what kind of qualities your spotting scope has. And who knows, I might pick up one of those. I do want to test a handful, beginning with the Bushnell LMS-2. Or no, LMSS, I think it's called. That thing is a monster. It sounds like it has really pristine qualities, and then it also has a reticle on the inside too, and I've gotten kind of used to that. It's nice. But yeah, a lot of the things that we've talked about with rifle scopes, we need to be looking for. We need to see how its resolution works at its maximum zoom to see if it can actually resolve those details really, really small at its maximum power. This one, for example, doesn't do that. This one actually rolls off its optical quality once you get past 32x. This is a 15 to 45, and as you get past that 32 mark, it's more like you're just zooming in on whatever level of detail you had at 32. It's like the digital zooms on cheap digital cameras, how they just kind of took the pixels that they had and then they blew them up and mushed them a bit. It's the same sort of thing. This is still useful in all the situations that I talked about. We've used this when we took our rifles out to a mile. We can spot bullet trace pretty well with this, and I can see my impacts. But as I start to get to, say, past 400 yards, I can't really see bullet holes anymore, especially if it's something smaller like 243 Winchester. But everything else also applies. You want to make sure that you have a very bright image that's going to be affected by the size of your objective lens, as long as your eyes can manage that exit pupil. Yeah, all that stuff like exit pupil is going to come into play here. So you can get a lot of light down at dusk. If you're in the store and you are testing one of these out, try to find a dark little nook. Take a look in there, see if you can still see good contrast and detail down in a shadow area. And especially if you're at a Bass Pro Shop, you'll probably be able to find some good shadow areas to simulate dusk. See how the colors pop and compare them between your two eyes. You should be able to see color pretty much the same between your two eyes. If one of them, if looking through the scope looks a bit more dull than through your natural eye, then it might have some limited abilities to be able to see what's actually going on out there. If you're trying to pick out an animal who is camouflaged out in the woods and you can't see those little color details, then you might have some difficulty tracking that down. And this one is kind of like that as well. This one doesn't have the ability to reproduce color all that well. Just because this is the only spotting scope I've ever owned, this isn't the only one that I've ever tried. I've had a chance to use quite a few out at the range to test some out, and I do have some that I can recommend to you. The Konus 20 to 60 by, I think it's a 100 millimeter objective, it's huge. That one I have gotten to use a few times out in F-class matches. You know, people will bring their own stuff out and set it up, and we want to use theirs, not mine. But yeah, looking through that, it's an amazing price for an amazing scope. It actually has much better detail than you might expect at its price point. It is very good. It doesn't have some of the crazy features like, you know, the reticle on the inside, but I don't care. I can actually see what's going on. And to me, that has become much more important. The Vortex Razor HD is another one that I can highly recommend. It is extremely crisp, and it does really start to step up that price tag, but it does so for a good reason. It's a very bright image. It's just very large overall. It has some pretty good zooms to it, and at any of those magnifications, you can see detail really well. Another one that I see a whole lot, especially during match time, is going to be the KOWAs. That's K-O-W-A. I'm going to put links to some of these that I talk about down in the description below so you can get direct links and check those out. But the KOWA models are very well known by competitors for having a very good image, and these do really start to step that price tag up. These are ones that in some cases you can switch around the eyepiece, and actually that's something that I hadn't mentioned yet. Some of these have some accessories to think about. Ones like the Bushnell LMSS2, you can actually put rails on top, so you can have maybe a red dot sight or some very low power scope so you can get on target quicker. Sometimes if you have a high magnification spotting scope, you can have difficulty actually pointing at the right target quickly. And if you have something on top that's kind of a low magnification, a red dot, you can just point that really quickly where you're supposed to be looking and then get your eye into the eyepiece to be able to see what's going on there. Some of these will also have eyepieces you can switch out that can either change your magnification or they can add reticles. You can get some pretty cool effects with some of the more expensive models, so you can swap these out. And that leads us to a couple of others that I'd like to point out that actually do have reticles that you can swap out on these. You have the Nikon, I think the Monarch series. They have come up with some new scopes recently that look like they are really good. Supposedly they have very good optical quality, and you can swap eyepieces on those to include milling reticles. So if you want to go from birding over the weekend to tactical work during the week sometime, you can swap that out and you can actually start to measure some of your targets out there. The other one that I mentioned, the Bushnell LMSS2, I really want to try one of those because I keep hearing reports on how clean and clear that image is, and the ability to have an FFP reticle is, it's pretty tantalizing for me. Yeah, it's kind of expensive, but I want to try it and see how it goes. That might be the one that I come home with. If you're on a tight budget and you'd like a spotting scope that has a milling reticle, you should take a look at the Bushnell Legend T series. This is kind of the modern version of the one that you see here on my bench. They took a lot of the same ideas and they applied better glass, and I mean much better glass overall. It is just a much better image. You get better optical clarity so you can see more detail. The color is a whole lot better and it functions a lot better past dusk. It's just a much brighter image. However, I think these folded light path ones have some kind of inherent issue. I don't know if it has to do with the prisms that bounce the light around, but they don't it's kind of like a strange astigmatism. I've never seen anything quite like it. At least the one that I tested, it took objects that were out of focus especially and started to turn them into sort of a triangle shape. It was kind of strange. It was kind of making everything into just slightly turning it into a pyramid. I never did check the bokeh on that one to see what it looked like. I'd be kind of curious because I'm betting that the bokeh isn't round on it. It's still a good scope, but just be aware that if you're trying to favor the optical qualities, I'd say go for one of the others that I've mentioned. And if you want the extra feature, then that Bushnell Legend T-Series is actually a pretty fun little thing. It does work out in the field. Thanks a lot for watching, you guys. Like I said, we have one last video in this series where we're going to talk about mounts and rings, which is a pretty important topic, but thankfully we have a lot more good options out there, especially for those of us that are on a budget. And we're going to talk about some of the ones that I tend to favor. If you have gotten anything out of this series, please share this with your friends. Let folks know about it. I think this is something that a lot of people could use because I still do see this question all the time. Like we talked about in the first video, what scope do I get for a 308 rifle? It's the wrong question. There's a lot more detail that needs to go into that. There are a few more questions that you need to ask before you can actually get to that right answer. So yeah, if you have missed out on previous videos in this series, please check the whole thing out because this is all purpose driven and it's going to help us to find not just a scope that everybody else likes, but the one that works for us and our individual situations. And after we get done with this series, we're going to start talking about some individual scopes. I'm going to do some individual scope reviews, and I'll be able to tell you some of my favorites that I've used in different scenarios and how they apply. But yeah, thanks a lot for watching. Make sure that you subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss new videos when they come up. And thanks a lot to patrons of the Destructive Arts for making videos like these possible. They're the ones that buy the lights and the microphones and some of the other gear that you see here, like little tripods and scopes and things like that. Thank you to our 338 Lapua Magnum patrons, Sportsman's Guide, Stan and Mary, and Tyler. And then at the 300 Win Mag level, we have Joseph Davis, Peter, Howard, and Mr. No Name, and we have just a gob of other folks that are chipping in a buck or two a month to help keep videos like these coming. Thanks a lot for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, be sure to like, share, and most importantly, subscribe. Even if you didn't like this particular content, go ahead and subscribe. There's probably something coming that's more up your alley. Check out this playlist right here. This is going to have videos in a similar vein to what you just watched. These two videos we cherry-picked for you. And finally, The Social Regressive is on Patreon. So, you can become a patron of the Destructive Arts and earn some goodies while helping us to provide high-quality videos just by kicking us a few bucks a month. Thanks a bunch for your patronage.